Finding redfish during the dog days of summer can be a little difficult, but that doesn't mean it's impossible, and you can actually have some really good days even in the dead heat of summer if you know where to look based on a redfish's biology. So in this video, I want to cover a question that's been asked by our insiders from the Carolinas to Florida to Texas about the number one spot I would look to consistently catch redfish during the dead heat of summer. Now, before I show you guys some examples of what these spots look like on satellite imagery, I kind of want to go through a checklist for summer redfish, things you're going to want to look for when you scout these spots out on your own so you understand what makes them productive. Now, the first thing I like to look for when I'm going after reds in the summertime is areas with higher levels of DO2. DO2 stands for dissolved oxygen. Now, fish need this. Inshore predators like snook, trout, redfish especially, need this to function like we need oxygen. It's basically how they breathe. So they're looking for water that has higher levels of DO2 because in the summertime, as those water temperatures rise, the DO2 levels drop. So we need to find, number one, cooler water or other factors that are going to encourage higher levels of DO2. Moving water is going to generally be a little bit cooler, so areas with slightly higher current flow, areas with seagrass are really good, and areas that have a little bit lighter bottom. Again, mud tends to hold more heat, and that is going to, again, rise that water temperature and lower the DO2 levels. So we're looking for lighter bottom, seagrass, higher current flow, and lastly, probably the most important when you first go to look for where you're going to want to fish, is areas that are closer to passes or inlets that are connected to the Atlantic or connected to the Gulf. This is going to bring in colder water from the ocean, and that is again going to lower that water temperature and raise those DO2 levels. So again, we are looking for areas of higher DO2. Now, the second thing I'm going to be looking for is areas that have both shallow and deep water hunting opportunities, because the redfish are going to switch in between the two based on the time of day and the actual temperature that it is outside, because it's very cool in the evening and night, and it starts to warm up in the morning, and by midday it's really hot again. So those fish typically will try to feed in the shallows when it's comfortable for them to do so. We got to remember they're cold-blooded, so their hunting opportunities are really just based on the external temperature. They can't choose to feed up in the shallows if they, you know, just want to, because it's too hot. Their bodies can't actually handle that temperature, so they have to move to areas where they can feed deep. And an example of a shallow and deep water hunting opportunity would be an oyster bar that lines the edge of a flat. Fish could feed on the shallow side where there's the potholes and the grass and everything like that, or they could feed on the intercoastal channel side where it's a little bit deeper, a little bit cooler. If it's, say, the middle of the day, there's generally going to be bait that congregates all around that oyster bar, but they can choose to hunt in the shallows if they are comfortable to do so, if it's earlier on in the day or later in the evening when it starts to cool off. But if it's later on in the day and it's really hot, they can feed on the deeper side where they're going to be comfortable as well. I typically try to pick areas that have these multiple opportunities, because if you just get locked into fishing shallow or fishing deep, you might find yourself getting skunked, because redfish might be holding on one of those types of structure based on the factors for that day. Now, the third thing I like to look for in the summertime is conveyor belts of food. And I've talked about this concept in other seasons, but I believe it is most important in the summertime when, again, fish are dictated to where they can feed by the temperatures. And generally, they're going to place themselves in areas where they don't have to move around a whole lot to go look for bait, because, again, really warm temperatures are going to do a lot to these fish's bodies. It's going to stress them out. They're not going to have a lot of energy to forage around and go hunting. So they're going to localize themselves in spots where they're going to constantly have a good flow of bait. Now, areas that you can usually find a conveyor belt of food is entry and exit points on mud flats, grass flats, areas that have a lot of current flow. And generally, you can spot these areas if you look at a satellite imagery view of one of these large mud flats in the Carolinas, or a large grass flat that's in the Texas area or Florida. Generally, what you're going to see is these really deep cuts where you can tell there's a lot of tidal movement. What's going to happen is, on outgoing tides, all that bait that's in the middle of the flat that those predators may not be able to get to in some of the shallowest parts of these areas is going to get pulled out by the tide through these cuts, and then those predators are generally going to stack up close to those cuts and just easily pick off those prey items as they are moved through those areas. Same thing's going to happen on incoming tide. All that bait gets flushed onto the flat by the tide, and those predators are going to sit on the inside of the cut, on the inside of these flats, and wait for that bait to get in as well. So it's just an easy area to always know that you're going to have a good inflow, outflow of bait, and that's a conveyor belt for these predators when they're looking for zones that they can just kind of hang out when there's really hot days and they don't have to do a whole lot of work to find their food. So those are the three things that I like to look for: high levels of DO2, shallow and deep water hunting opportunities, and conveyor belts of bait. These three factors are things that I believe you must have if you're going to find a really consistent redfish spot in the summertime. So let's go ahead and hop on some satellite imagery and take a look at some examples of spots that are consistent for summer redfish with all three of these things. Now for this first image we're looking at, this is going to be an example of a great spot to find redfish in the summertime in a marsh type of environment. And what this actually is the entrance to several different small creek channels. We've got some marsh mazes over to the right and an intercoastal channel over to the left. And this is a good example of shallow and deep water hunting opportunities, as well as areas that are going to have good levels of DO2 and conveyor belts of bait. So again, we've got this intercoastal channel over to the left side of this image. And what that's going to do is make sure that this area, again, does have good DO2 and good current flow, because that intercoastal channel is going to be a little bit deeper. And again, this area is located close to a pass or an inlet. So we've got good cold water that's going to be entering this area. So we can mark that off of our checklist. What we also have is shallow and deep water hunting opportunities with this oyster bar that we see over here in the middle, as well as some scallop shorelines that have tons of nice little points, and some of these little entrances to creeks that we see over on the right side of the image. These are all a bunch of very small spots within a single spot that are going to provide redfish with multiple hunting opportunities in both shallow and deep water hunting scenarios. Now what we're going to see in terms of bait conveyor belts is a lot of bait coming out of these marsh creeks on outgoing tides. So these areas are going to be really hot as the bottom of the outgoing tide occurs, and then those oyster bars are going to be really good zones, especially on the points where we see all that water dumping out into the intercoastal channel. A lot of redfish will stack up on the edges of these types of oyster bars and wait for all that bait to get pulled off the bar with the tide, and they'll just sit in that deep depth change right in front of the oyster bar. I've seen this on flats before, and you can have some really good success in these types of areas. So it's a really good zone to be focused on as that tide drops out, but also as the tide begins to come back in, redfish will really hug that bar as that bait tries to congregate around those shells and find protection, and they'll be picking shrimp off and little bait fish, things like that. Oyster bars are always great zones to be looking for redfish, but also the shoreline that's close to that oyster bar looks really good as well. There's a lot of small points and scallop little coves that redfish will push up against really tight as that tide starts to get really high, and you'll see them tailing up against the grass looking for shrimp, crustaceans, crabs, little bait fish that are trying to get into the grass, things like that. This is where you find a lot of tailing redfish. So again, we've got our three things checked off. We've got shallow and deep water hunting opportunities. We've got good levels of DO2 from the intercoastal channel. And then we've also got some really good conveyor belts of food. That gives everything redfish need in a small localized area. So this technically is one spot, but it is also several spots within a single spot, which is really what we're looking for when we're looking for a really good zone to find reds in the summer. Now moving on to the grass flat types of areas, we're going to take that exact same concept and apply it here. We're looking for shallow and deep water hunting opportunities. You can see we've got a deeper channel that runs onto this grass flat sitting right in the middle. So right there, starting right off the bat, we've got shallow and deep water hunting opportunities because there are potholes and there's grass that those redfish could root around for crustaceans and small bait fish in. But if they need to drop into the kind of deeper channels, they can look for crabs and small bait fish on the edges of the flat that are getting kind of pulled out on outgoing tides, things like that. This is again an area that's close to an intercoastal channel. You can see over to the right where there's that deeper water that is the intercoastal channel. So we've got some good DO2 that's going to be coming in from some colder passes and inlets close by. Again, we're always going to be looking for those zones that are close to passes and inlets. If you can find flats, marsh creeks, things like that that are close to those areas, you're insured that there's going to be a lot of DO2 in that area. And actually, this is a large oyster bar right in the middle as well. So we know that there's just, again, a lot of different opportunities for these redfish to get up shallow and hunt. I talked about the importance of oyster bars in the marsh creeks. Same thing is going to apply here. And lastly, conveyor belts of food. It's very easy to see, again, with the intercoastal channel dictating where the tide is going to flow into and off of this flat. We can see all the bait's going to get pulled straight through that channel close to that oyster bar, so the reds can position themselves on outgoing tides just sitting right in that channel on that bend where it's deepest, or right around the point of the oyster bars, even close to that little island as that bait's kind of pulled out towards the channel. There's a lot of great ambush zones on outgoing tides, and then incoming tides, it's the same story. They're just going to put themselves in advantageous positions where that tide's going to be flowing in, and they're just going to be sitting right where that bait's going to get flushed onto the flat. Again, maybe on the other side of the island, on the edge of those depth channels, or even on the inside of that point of the oyster bar. So lots of opportunities there for them to get onto food.
So this just is another example of an easy area to find fish in the summertime.
So regardless of where you live, whether that be Texas, Florida, the Carolinas, if you make sure that you have those three things in your game plan when you go to pick your spots, you can find some very consistent action with redfish, even when it is 90 degrees outside and everyone says it's too hot to be fishing. So I hope you guys enjoyed this tip and know that all the information that I've shared for you guys is just a small taste of the awesome info that we have in the Salt Strong Insider Club, in addition to live on the water weekly reports that me, Luke, and Tony publish, and tons of awesome courses with really deep dives into the biology of fish like we talked about today, but in even greater detail. There's just so much awesome stuff in there that I hope you guys will come and check out at saltstrong.com.
And if you're new to Salt Strong, just know that we're the best online fishing club in America, because we literally guarantee we're going to help you catch more fish while saving time and money on your tackle. We do this by providing you with premium education, a private insider community with thousands of reports published daily, and discounts on the best saltwater fishing tackle in the industry right now. So we're looking forward to seeing you join us in the Salt Strong Insider Club soon, and thanks again for watching.